as always, when we have public meetings, we start out with a pledge of allegiance. The flag is to my right back, if you can all stand. The city of America.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic of the United States, and to the republic of the United States,
Thank you. So those of you who've been here before or watched on TV, usually we have public comments a couple of times during board meetings. We're going to forego that so we can get through some of the agenda items, and then we'll move to the presentation about the capital improvement plan. So the first thing on there is to approve an agreement on personnel. A resolve that the Board of Education of Tuckahoe Union Free School District hereby approve a certain letter agreement dated September 26, 2016, and executed by one party on October 17, 2016, in connection with the transportation of a student, ID number 12487, copy of which letter agreement has previously been reviewed by the members of the Board of Education. Do we have a motion? Rob, second. Danielle, discussion? All in favor? Opposed? We are going to table number two. Number three, approve a merger agreement. Resolve to approve the October 17, 2016 agreement, which sets forth the terms and conditions between the district and Bronxville School District for merging ice hockey teams for the 2016-2017 school year, and further to approve Steve Forzagilia as varsity ice hockey coach and Adam Benicetti as modified ice hockey coach. Do we have a motion? Danielle, second. Michelle, discussion? I will say that we're doing this under the assumptions that the Bronxville School District has certified that these coaches are certified. All in favor? Opposed? Number four, approve an hourly rate. Resolve on recommendation of the superintendent of schools to appoint Donna Roselle as a clerical worker in the special education department on an as-needed basis from November 8, 2016 through June 30, 2017 at a rate of pay of $46.80 per hour, not to exceed $940. Do I have a motion? Michelle, second. Rob, discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Number five, approve a leave replacement. Resolve on recommendation of the superintendent of schools to appoint Nicole Toko to a 20-week leave replacement at the position of school psychologist at the William E. Connell School effective November 21st, 2016 through April 7, 2017, or sooner at the discretion of the Board of Education on a Step 3 MA of the TTA salary schedule. Do you have a motion? Danielle, second. Rob, discussion? All in favor? And that is the end of our board business. So, again, I won't adjourn the meeting until we go back into executive session, so we're going to pause it now. And what I would like to do is to invite our superintendent of schools, Carl Albano, to start us off the workshop here for the capital improvement plan. Again, thank you for all that are in attendance, and those of you who are at home, thanks for watching. We'll give you all an opportunity to kind of ask questions about what you want to take as an important day in our school's history. So, Carl.
Thanks, Steve. Good evening. Just want to invite those people in the back, if you don't have a clear view, please, by all means, feel free to move up. And our Board of Education, I think you probably want to take some seats in front of the smart board. So first, I just want to say thank you for taking the time to join us this evening. It's very important that we have community feedback on what I believe is a very, very important initiative here at the Tuckahoe School District. I'm going to begin by just recognizing the Tuckahoe Facilities Exploratory Committee. So there have been 23 volunteers who, back in November and December a year ago, came forth and volunteered to participate and dedicate their time to planning a potential capital project. In January, January 2016, we officially got underway, and at the Board of Education's request, the committee and approval, the committee began to meet regularly, sometimes every month, and sometimes we had to skip a month. But basically, these community members represented what, in my opinion, a good cross-section of the community and a wide range of skills and experience and background. Some of the committee members had children currently in the district. Others have had children who have already graduated. We also had some staff members. And again, I just want to sincerely thank everyone. I think most of them are here this evening for giving us all that time and working so diligently on this important initiative. They began in January doing data reviews. Basically, we looked at demographic studies of our school district, and most people here, I believe, know that the enrollment has been growing pretty rapidly. They also looked at a very in-depth building condition survey to get a better understanding of our building and the needs. We also did a tour. We went down to the boiler rooms. We basically toured every inch of buildings in throughout the district. They also looked at proposals from various architectural firms that were interested in working for the Tuckahoe School District. I believe we had 7 proposals that were submitted. We ended up selecting 3 firms to interview, and eventually the committee unanimously recommended KG&D Architects, and they are here with us this evening, to guide us through this capital project. We also reviewed and discussed various capital project options with our architects and our business official, and that occurred, those discussions happened throughout the summer and into the fall. And then we analyzed the financial impact of a proposed capital project in September and October 2016. We also agreed upon a recommendation to be presented to our Board of Education here this evening. We started by trying to really understand the needs of this district. And what were the concerns related to our facilities. And first, we had to accommodate our surging enrollment, particularly down at the Cottle School. So right now, as of today, our elementary school, which houses pre-K through 5, is at a record 643 students in attendance. Also, our schools have an aging infrastructure. You know, the middle high school building is a beautiful building and with a historical architecture, but it is 86 years old, and some of the infrastructure is original. We have original pipes and original facilities, that are in need of repair. And when we're talking about infrastructure, it is important to understand that you don't want to wait until a boiler is down. If that were to occur during the middle of a school year, it would disrupt learning. You would end up paying much more than you would pay if you approach it in a proactive way. So that was an important part of the committee's learning experience, to really understand what this building and the elementary school building needed. Also, we looked through the lens of health and safety and security in our schools. We had some air quality tests done last year throughout the spring. The committee considered that, air quality, also safety. You may be aware that we currently are required to do 4 lockdown drills a year. Used to be 2, now it's up to 4. We do that together with the Eastchester Police Department and really examine our safety and how we're protecting our children and what we would do in any given emergency situation. We also looked at examine our main entrances, our visitors' procedures, our interior doors, exterior doors, what do we do in a lockdown situation? Is the building safe and secure? We also looked at energy efficiency and what we could do to improve in that area. Our goals, which many of you have heard in the past, our school mission is to prepare every student for excellence, but the committee thought about this very, very carefully, and improving instructional space to ensure that every student is prepared for college and a globally competitive career opportunity was important to the committee. We thought about 21st century learning and what that means. And today, just to give you some examples, it's a student-centered learning environment and interdisciplinary learning or inquiry-based learning. Also, technology integration, which we've come a long way with here in the district, and also real-world problem solving. And we thought about what does that mean in our existing space, and how do we obtain this, or how do we change the existing space to meet these goals? We also thought about our science programs and technology and engineering and art and music and how they all fit together in an interdisciplinary model. We looked at our pre-K through 12 facilities and talked about how we can maintain a continuum from the elementary school right through to the high school. And we also took a close look at our athletics facilities and our gymnasiums, and health, phys ed, and athletics is an important initiative here in the district. We've recently hired a full-time director of health, phys ed, and athletics. One of his main charges is to grow and expand the athletics programs here. And he's doing a great job, but we realized he also needs the facilities to make that become a reality. Our finances. For the past 5 years, the Tuckahoe District has worked hard to stay under the New York State imposed tax cap. In fact, this past year, we went up a fraction of a percent. It was less than 0.4%. However, even with that tax cap, we've been able to expand, add staffing, add program, and do some very creative things for the school. We've been fiscally prudent in implementing various cost-saving strategies. We've offered retirement incentives, for example. We've brought students who were placed out of district back into district at a cost savings, and also offering a higher quality education. We've also increased revenues by attracting non-resident tuition students to Tuckahoe, and there's well over $1 million in tuition revenue that flows into our school every year and is very helpful, but also that requires some space. And also we've pursued grants, and just to name a few, we have a pre-kindergarten grant. The pre-kindergarten program that exists here is largely funded by state grant money. Year after year, we go after that. Smart schools, we received $222,000 in smart schools grant money, which is earmarked for technology. And that was from New York State at no expense to the local taxpayers. And then reward school money. We received, over the past 2 years, $150,000 in reward school money to improve our curriculum and instruction and add professional development activities. Under this tax cap, we've also been able to increase our tax certiorari reserves. And that is something that I'm going to really save for our business official, Lee Liu, who we'll discuss later. But we're very pleased that we've been able to add money to a fund where if a tax cert comes our way, we're able to pay it, and we do not have to borrow to pay it at this point in time. Of course, that can change in the future, but right now we worked hard to be able to afford to pay those outstanding tax liabilities as they come due. The last thing about finance that I will discuss, and then Lee will elaborate later, is we are in a record low interest rate environment. And because we've been prudent, our rating is very strong. And right now, Tuckahoe can borrow at a rate of 2%. Tonight, we're going to have our architects get into a very detailed plan. And I know that's the main reason why everyone is here. But after that, a very important aspect of the presentation is the financial piece of it. And Lee will work on that and present that to the audience. After that, we will encourage a lot of feedback. Our board will make comments first or ask clarifying questions. And then we're going to invite the audience, whether it's our facilities committee members or just people from the audience who are interested or concerned. We will invite you up to the microphone. You'll have an opportunity to ask questions and get some clarification and or feedback. But first, before I close, I'd like to talk about the alternatives if we do either nothing, which is an option, certainly, or if we decide to go forward and go forward with a capital project, but it takes at least 2 or 3 years, what are some of the issues that we're facing? Well, first, we believe this year we'll need to relocate the pre-kindergarten program. If we have one additional class, there is not one empty classroom at Cottle. And in fact, we're making creative use of even closets that have been turned into offices. Anyone can visit Mr. Kilgallen and see his space. I think he has about maybe 6 square feet. But he makes it work, and under the current conditions, it's unfortunately what we need to do. But we do know that there is an option to maintain our grant and potentially give vouchers out to students who or families of students who win the lottery. And that's important because we don't want to lose the grant. We've had it for about 9 years, and it's about $56,000 a year. We want to maintain that. So in the interim period, we're thinking about offering vouchers to families. Next, you may be aware at Cottle, this year, unfortunately, we had to dismantle the art room and create an academic space there, and we're offering art on a cart. That is far from ideal, but it was a necessity. So Ms. Durbin, our art teacher, has been very good about adapting, but she travels into each classroom and is not efficient, and she cannot do everything that she would love to do. However, we have no choice at this point in time. But if we continue to grow and we continue to get additional sections of classes, we may need to go to music on a cart. And I think that would be a shame because it's very, very difficult to lug around a keyboard or music instruments and teach music effectively. So we're hoping it doesn't get to that point, but that is a very real option, and we're talking about every option. Everything is on the table. Another option that I'm not pleased with, but it has to be considered, is potentially moving the fifth grade classes here to the middle high school. Why I don't like that option is just age appropriateness, developmentally appropriate, interactions with students. Our middle and high school kids are great, but to have 10-year-olds together with, 18-year-olds doesn't sit right with me. But we may have to consider that at least temporarily, and we would do the best we can. If that were to happen, we'd have to relocate the district offices. Years back, some of you may recall our central office, the business office, the superintendent's office, special education, was all down in the village of Tuckahoe. We rented some office space. It was far from ideal. People complained that they didn't have access to us. I know the central office team did not like being so far from the building and the students and the parents, but that is something that is very much on the table as well. Also, we may have to postpone infrastructure work. The work that we believe is absolutely necessary is plumbing, heating, brick pointing, roofing, among some other things. It would be, in my opinion, a mistake to put that work off. As I said earlier, if the heating system goes in the middle of January, that is a problem. We would miss instructional time. We could potentially have to close school, and we probably would end up paying a lot more than had we approached it proactively. Also, at this point, with the surging enrollment, we probably would have to limit physical education classes. Right now, the Cottle Gymnasium is maxed out as far as scheduled phys ed classes. So there's not much more we could do in the way of offerings, but also our athletic programs up here at the middle and high school, we are limited by our space. And think about it, in a district with three schools, in most cases, you would have three gymnasiums. Here in Tuckahoe, we're working with two. So these are some restrictions. By all means, I want people to understand this is not a scare tactic at all, but I thought I needed to be upfront and be realistic about if we either do nothing or even if we decide together to move forward, we have a real challenge on our hands as far as a space issue here in the Tuckahoe School District. The other thing I'd like to just say is, as your superintendent, I'm very excited about the plan and the work that the committee did. However, I do not live in Tuckahoe, and I do not pay taxes here. I happen to live in Mamaroneck. I pay tax there. So it is really not my place, and it's not appropriate for me to push for one particular plan or another. I have my own opinions on what I think would be best, and I'm happy to share them, but I really believe sincerely that the community has to be involved in this process. Pleased that we have a good crowd here this evening, but after this presentation is over, we will be airing it on TV, we will have it on the website. Please go out, encourage your neighbors to get involved and to understand what we're trying to do here, what the needs are, because we want your feedback. I know the Board of Education also really wants feedback, because this is a major decision, okay? So on that note, I'm going to turn it over to Russ Davidson, KG&D Architects. I'll exit out of my slide here, Russ.
Good evening. So I'm here with Walter Hauser. We're both principals at KG&D, so we're going to try this. We're Walter does the slideshow, and I can point. So thank you for the nice introduction, Carl. Again, we were brought on to facilitate a committee process. So this is what you're seeing here tonight is sort of the results of that committee process. So, and we're going to go very quickly through what's been completed. I don't want to block you, I'm sorry, but there's a table in the way here. A little bit about enrollment and capacity, the model elementary school program, and then the option that the board, that the committee wanted to recommend for further consideration, and then what would happen if this does go forward in terms of next steps. So we took a look at your enrollment projections. These were provided by the district, and you'll see that the 612 is the red line, and K-5 is the blue line for Cottle. So you can see that the Cottle is looked to be pretty steady, but it's got a bulge, but the high school actually continues up. So these are pretty accurate projections, typically. And what they what you're normally obligated to do is plan the elementary for 5 years out and that the high school for 10 years out, because that's about the life of the a reasonable enrollment projection. So the next thing we did is we looked at the capacity of the buildings. How many students does each building reasonably hold? So we did this in a very granular fashion. We took the plans, we measured every space, we created a list, and we generated a functional capacity. We used the preferred class sizes because you can always put more kids in a building if you just load up all the classrooms. But the functional capacity is based on K-1 classes of having about 18 students, grades 1 through 5, 20, and grades 6 through 12, 25. So they're not crazy large, they're not crazy small. That's the functional capacity. And then we use regular efficiency factors that are used in other capacity methods. And if you have some undersized rooms, we adjusted the capacity based on the undersized rooms. And this is what we come up with. So this is K-5. So this is the target enrollment, somewhere around 610, 620. And the functional capacity of that building is only around 560. So you can see that there's a big gap of students' capacity versus enrollment at Cottle. But I got a little concerned when you said you might move the fifth grade up to the middle school, high school, because the capacity and the enrollment of the middle school, high school are right about maxed out. There's really not a lot of extra room. You would definitely need to move the district office out to do that, and that means that these spaces back here would have to become classrooms somehow. So definitely need space at Cottle and no extra room at the middle school, high school is what this analysis said. But then we have to look at what type of spaces really belong in Cottle. So we interviewed the principal and we talked to the superintendent. We came up with a detailed listing of what should be in Cottle and what the size of each room is according to state standards. And that's what all the options were based on. Not how little space can you get by with, but what's the appropriate amount of space given the educational program that you offer today. And there are some things that you don't have in there, and one of them is science space for K-5. And we weren't able to actually get both science rooms in, but one of the ads is a science space. But it restores the art to a full-size room, keeps music as a general music room. So the model program is based on the full program. So here's Cottle. Everybody wants to know, why can't we park there? But that's not your property. It looks perfect, too. There's a lot here that's called the Rock Lot. Which is, we get a lot of proposals for that. And, you know, there's been some discussion about the possibility of utilizing Siwanoy Avenue. I believe that's moving forward in the discussions and that can be deeded over to the district, but it would need to remain as a fire lane for emergencies. And it also would need to, it could be closed off and all the utilities have to remain there, which would then become your responsibility to maintain. So this is the proposal for Cottle. So this is the existing building, the long sloping Cottle Elementary, skateboard paradise. And the basic proposal is to put a second floor right here over this wing of Cottle. All the drawings that we see indicate that it was designed to take a second floor. So you don't have any additional space, you need additional classroom space. So there'd be an addition to this side, a little addition here, so you get elevators and stairs, and we get 8 classrooms above, so that it basically gives you 5 sections of every grade level throughout the whole building, which you now have for some grade levels, not for others. But it restores 3 dedicated special ed rooms, as well as a room for the autistic program, which I think you just brought back to the district that Carl mentioned. And what this proposes to do is to take the existing gym and divide it in half. One half will remain a multi-purpose room or gym for the youngest children. The other side will become art and science rooms. We'll expand the library somewhat, expand the cafeteria somewhat, expand the main entrance so you get a legitimate security office. We get that desk out of the hallway and you have a real secure main entrance. But the biggest proposal here is to build a full-size sort of fitness or physical education building across the street in what some people call the Rock Lot area. So this would be a double height gymnasium that would have a full size basketball court suitable for older children as well. It would have movable bleachers, and then on the upper level, since it's a double height space, some built-in bleachers with office and lockers and toilets. So it'd be a standalone phys ed building. And what this site plan is showing is a series of bollards or some way of blocking off this street and doing something to Siwanoy Boulevard with decorative paving. So it feels more like a park when the road is closed. So children can safely pass from Cottle to the playground. And we can use some of this space for trees and play area. And the potential for a canopy, so that if you have to leave Cottle to go to the gym, you still have to go outside, but you could do it under cover. And we'll show you some images of that in a moment. So you would come like this, and the canopy would be very high over the over the street, so emergency vehicles could pass under it. But this way, you would be under cover, so no rain or no buildup of snow. The second floor, as we mentioned, has mostly fifth grade, and it would really function as a fourth and fifth grade wing, so only the oldest kids would be on the upper level. And below that, we would convert the front portion of Cottle into the district office. So the district office would move from here down to Cottle. We'd renovate these classroom areas. But with a new vestibule and a new reception area, it would really function as a separate building attached to Cottle. So you don't have to go into the school to get to the district office. You just come in here, and we looked carefully at the amount of office space. It has its own toilets, team areas, administrative space, and conference area. So you would get the district office finally would have sort of its own place in the district. Attached but separate entry and exit from the school building. So this is an image of a gymnasium that we did that's similar. We'd like to say we built it for you, but it'll take a little time. But when we said that the bleachers would pull out from one side and there'd be an upper level, this is just an image of a gymnasium we actually built of almost exactly that same size for the Somers School District. This shows the plan with the bleachers pulled out, and you actually could put loose chairs on the seats So you could actually get almost, 1,138 people could fit in that gym. So that's really a lot, and you could have your graduations and other big events in that gym when you put seating on the floor. And when you just have the bleachers, you have almost 500 seats in your bleachers, which I believe is significantly more than you have today. So what happens at the middle school, high school? In this proposal, we would actually restore the auditorium. So we can all turn around, we can tell where the balcony began and stop. So that's at about here. And restore the auditorium, update the lighting, the finishes, really turn it back into what it once was, which will bring the seat count way up. So you'll get about 680 seats on this level, and really make it back into what it was when it was built. Then we'd convert what's the business and special ed offices back into art rooms, renovate the cafeteria and the serving area to really update it. And then on the upper level, take out the space that's up there now. Restore the auditorium balcony, you get another 235 seats up there. And really do a comprehensive renovation of the library, expanding into an area here which now holds one of the art rooms, and make it into a 21st century learning center suitable for the digital age. So I hope you can see this. This is the this is just a little program we call SketchUp that shows an image. So that's the curving Saiwanoi Boulevard. Can people see that? And this is the canopy that would go up high and the canopy that would connect to the road. So it would be nice and open, would feel park-like, but you still can get firefighting access through there. If you decide you want to let traffic through, you could let one lane of traffic through as an option. But you can see how it's a much friendlier feeling connecting the school on this side to the sort of park area on the other side. This is another image looking the other way. This is the new gymnasium building. This is that curving pathway. And this is the canopy that would protect students before they cross over. And again, these are just concepts so you get a feel for it. There's a lot, will be a lot more design to be done. But again, to make it sort of shady and a safe place, because one of the most difficult things about Cottle, besides there's no parking, is the difficulty of getting students across a street to the play area. So this is that site plan that just shows that same sort of nice park-like lane. You'd still have room for a regulation softball field, 210 feet. It shows the gymnasium. Would be set down a little bit so that from the downhill side it would look like a two-story building, and from the uphill side it's going to look like a one-story building. So yes, there's rock removal involved, but we're going to push the building down into the site. And we think it's an interesting concept, and the committee really felt that it was worth carrying forward. So this is just some more images of things that we're talking about. There's that sketch again. You'll see the decorative paving. These are grass pavers that we could use so that if you decide to open up that lane, you could actually park on some of the parkland for special events by using grass pavers. These are the types of bollards. We'd need new play equipment. This is the type of canopies that we're talking about. This is a canopy we built at another school project, and it actually has a translucent plastic on it, so it's not dark. It lets the sun through. It's very cost effective. And then maybe for the canopy that's over the road that needs to be higher, we can look at some of these fabric structures. So it would look very friendly and soft and not institutional. Now to the less fun things, which would be infrastructure. You do have a lot of needs, and it's not that anyone's done anything wrong. Your buildings are very well maintained. But when you have an 86-year-old building, things just come due. So So you have a lot of stairs and concrete that's sort of cracking, and railings that you can see that are rusting out here on the retaining wall. And more stairs. You've got a lot of masonry work that needs to be done on your building, including repointing the chimney. You can see just there's a lot of repointing needed overall on your brickwork. And the really fun stuff is that you've got pipes that are leaking in disrepair, and this is causing you a lot of energy inefficiency. So this is actually spaces below the building that we're in now. These are your pipe tunnels. We send engineers down there to photograph this. And your boilers. And you do have an issue with one of your boilers. You can see it's in pretty tough shape. You can run on one boiler, but it's time to really address these things. So option A, number one, puts a second story addition on Cottle. It converts part of the current gymnasium to special subjects. It expands the library, cafeteria, and main entrance. The big change is a new physical education center opposite Cottle. In this building, the big change is it completely restores the auditorium here and the cafeteria and serving area, and expands and converts the library to a learning commons and innovation lab. And all of this allows you to move the district office down to that lower floor of Cottle Elementary. So here's the harder news. What do we think it all costs? And these are still under development. There's nothing final about these. But we've broken it down by site development, new construction, renovation for the Cottle and for the middle school, high school. District-wide infrastructure is now budgeted at $4,250,000. That basically includes fixing everything that we've talked about, plus updating your lighting and an allowance for air conditioning the upper floors of the middle school, high school. And you know, again, we're still going to refine these numbers as we go forward, but that brings you to about $31.5 million. Included in that is the auditorium renovation. Some people were interested in what does that cost, and that's really at about $3 million. Renovate the auditorium. And then there was other questions about what if we put synthetic turf on the Cottle field as well. This infrastructure budget, by the way, does include replacing the synthetic turf on your current field. So that is, it's time, does, is included in this number. But if you're going to add synthetic turf to Cottle, that'd be around $1.2 million, because that's a we'd have to start from scratch. There'd be grading, there'd be retaining walls, there'd be drainage. That is not included in the in this number of 31.5. It is. Yeah. So we know that's a big number, and that's why we're all here to listen. What would happen next? So we're going to continue to refine this infrastructure list. We have the engineering team in examining things. Obviously, there's a lot of listening to be done, and starting with tonight. Then the board would select an option, this one or some combination or a portion thereof, for consideration by the public. You'd have to complete the State Environmental Quality Review Act, or CEQA process, which does involve, because it's a historic building, if you do involve building across the street, there may be some things to study as part of that process, but it's generally not a problem. It's school property and you do own it. And then after approval of funding through a vote, the real detailed design work would commence. Then we have to submit it for state approval, and then upon state approval, bidding and construction proceeds. So post a successful vote, it's still a 2 to 3 year process before this gets done, depending on how it's all phased. And I think that's it for us. I think, Lee, you were going to talk a little bit about the financial impact.
Thank you. Okay, so the next step is to talk about how we might pay for a project like this, or any project that we might consider. So just to give a little background, the Tuckahoe community has a budget currently of $31.9 million. If you take a look at our last three tax levy increases, we've stayed under the tax cap. Our most recent tax levy increase was under 1%, or it was about a third of a percent. In terms of the financial community itself, there are 1,281 single-family homes in our school district. The rest of the properties in the district that are taxed are multifamily dwellings or commercial properties, and the total assessed value of the entire school district is $18,800,000. Now, that doesn't equate to the market value of all the properties in the district. There is what the state calls an equalization rate that converts that number to what the market value is of all the properties. And that equalization rate is currently for Tuckahoe 1.22, which means it's about 1.2% of the original assessed value is how you would convert it, and there's a formula you can do that. The median assessed value, or the typical home in Tuckahoe, is assessed at currently $8,500. That was a number given to me by the Town of Eastchester assessor. So that means half the homes are assessed at a higher value and half the homes are assessed at a lower value, but that's our median value. Our tax rate for our last budget was $1,429 and change per each $1,000 of assessed value of your house's assessed value. So for the typical home in Tuckahoe, that's assessed value of $8,500. That would equal about a $12,000 tax bill. In terms of the finances of the district, it's been considered very well run by Moody's Investor Service, just recently upgraded Tuckahoe to an AA3 rating, which is considered a strong rating, a very strong rating. And also, it's just good to note that interest rates are now at historical lows. So if, in fact, the district did want to proceed with a capital project, we would be borrowing at a very low interest rate, which would make repayment favorable. It's also important to remember that large-scale projects are difficult, or if not impossible, to accomplish within an annual budget, particularly when we have a tax cap environment like we do right now in New York State. We're limited to cost of living increases in order to raise our tax levy. So if we were to try to include many of these infrastructure or other types of projects in our regular ongoing budget, since we are limited to how much money we can raise from our taxpayers, we would have to consider other ways to fund maintenance by having to look at program or other areas. So there's always that trade-off there if we wanted to put it in our annual budget. The state does allow us to exclude capital repayments from our tax cap levy, so that if we did decide to go forward with a bonding project, the principal and interest repayments would be excluded from our tax cap, and we could be able to fund it that way. School districts are allowed to borrow by issuing bonds to fund large capital improvement projects, and by doing so, we're able to borrow at an advantageous interest rate. And it also allows us to group a lot of projects together so that we can maximize the state aid that the state will provide us with for doing these kinds of projects. Currently, Tuckahoe has a 23.6% state aid ratio. So not every single dollar spent in a capital project would be eligible to receive 23.5% back from the state. But most of it would be, so that the state would be providing, I did the math, and for this particular project, they would be providing almost 20% back to us. So 20% of the cost of this project would be paid for by the state. School districts also may only borrow the amount of funds that are authorized by voter-approved referendums, so that the voters would have to approve any project that we wanted to do, and they would have to, if any, there are any cost overruns, we could not spend any more than what was approved by the district, by the voters. So we have to be very careful to price out the projects as well as we can and to present it to the community, and whatever is authorized is what we're able to spend. If for any reason the district wanted to spend more, they would have to go back to the voters for approval. If we spend less, we can obviously return the money to the, or not borrow it. So the total project cost, as we were shown for this project, was $31.4 million. So if we took out a $31.4 million bond, I spoke with our capital markets advisors to find out what it would cost us in terms of repayment. They priced that on a 15-year bond to be conservative, and also because that would tie into the time period that most likely we would get the state aid back on the project, over 15 years. So the cost of, at about 2%, the cost of the $31.4 million bond is about $2.5 million a year for principal and interest repayments. From that, we would subtract $350,000, which we would be getting back in state building aid. So our net cost after the building aid was taken out of that figure was about $2.1 million. So if you take a look, the annual average cost to a typical home in Tuckahoe would be $956. But however, on the next slide I'll show you that we are paying off debt going forward. So some of that cost of the $956 of debt payments would be mitigated by some of the debt that's maturing in the district. I know this is a little hard to see, but basically what it's showing you is the second column shows us what our current debt payment schedule looks like based on debt that the district's taken out over the past, goes back to 1999. Some of that is for the last addition we did on the high school. Some of it is for tax certiorari reimbursements. Some of it is for a lease project that we did to replace some heating equipment in the past. So as you can see, we're currently paying about $2.1 million right now this year. And as we go through to the next 15 years or so, we go down to zero. If we did decide to go forward with a project of this size, the third column shows the net new debt that the district would be taking on for this project. So as I said, it would be $2.1 million a year, but if we net out what we're retiring and what we've paid off, this is what the new debt would look like in the third column. And that would be, the final column would show the actual cost to the typical home in Tuckahoe. So we wouldn't even really start borrowing if we went forward right away. We wouldn't even start our borrowing until the 2018-19 school year and need to repay any money at that point in time. And it would be, by that time, we would have retired some debt. So the initial payment to the taxpayer would cost about $917. And it would go down especially significantly a few years in, down to the $600 cost range. And then after about 10 years, it would basically not be any more than what we're currently paying now in terms of debt, principal and interest payments that we make currently now. And the next steps would, of course, be more discussion and community input. So, thank you.
Thank you, Russ. Thank you, Lee. Now, this time, the board is going to return to the front of the auditorium. I think we're going to hear comments from each board member. And then shortly after that, we will invite our audience up to the microphone on my left, your right. Steve? Yep.
Well, I'll just start off with a couple of comments, and then I'll pass on to my fellow board members. First, I want to thank the committee. I know it's been many nights late in the library. I started on this committee way back about almost a year ago or so, 6 months ago, 8 months ago, when Dodge and Rob were elected to the school board. Then we had a conflict because you can't have three board members in the same room talking about school business, so I excused myself from that. So I do know some of the community members that were involved in this, and thank you very much, as well as staff members. I also want to thank Rob and Dodge for stepping up, and Lee and Carl, who were at many of those meetings as well. KG and D, I think that was a great presentation. Thanks for your efforts. I think it's very clear to me what our vision looks like. See it, and those that are watching online. I understand it's not on TV yet, but we'll get it on there on a repeat. I guess the questions I have, and I'll start out with a couple of them, is one of the things that we were discussing was the improvement in security, and security is something that's important to me. And I know that with the district offices now kind of being separated from the building, maybe we can control some of the flow at Cottle, but I didn't see a lot mentioned about security at the general building, and were there things that the committee and the architectural team discussed in regards to upping up some of the security that we have in the building now?
There is a new security vestibule at Cottle, and we would look at the front entrance to see if we could create some sort of vestibule there, but we're a little concerned because it's such a historic building and the lobby is so nice, it's going to be challenging, but we'll continue to look at that. Yes.
Okay, great.
Steve, if I may, just to comment on that, I think one of the things that could come out of if the project was to go as proposed, moving the district offices down to Cottle was also one of the things when it came to security we thought would be beneficial, because it would have a separate entrance and those offices would be separated from the school, as opposed to up here at the high school. If you come in the front doors, in order to access that, you then have access to the rest of the school. So one of the benefits of the district's office being kind of positioned where they were was to actually provide some security as well for people who were coming in to see any of the administrators.
No, I agree. I think that's
a good point.
I'm
sorry, could you actually show the slide again that shows where the district offices are?
It'll take a minute.
Thank you.
While Russ is finding that slide that Michelle asked for, also we have talked about our lock system and our doors. In doing lockdown drills, we realized, for example, at Cottle, we have multiple keys for different classrooms. And we did talk about a system within the infrastructure budget of having swipe cards and something that we could control and, of course, deprogram almost like as you would at a hotel. So that is something that a lot of districts are moving towards, and that is something that has been considered very seriously.
So this is the Cottle building, and the district offices are on the lower floor front. So it's actually pretty short to the middle school, high school, and again, their entrance is at the end, and that they never have to go in the building to get to the district offices. So even though it's attached, it's really like a separate building.
And that, I do want to say, I do like the idea of having the district office separate. I think it helps with a lot of things of the flow of traffic. I'll ask one more question, and I'll pass it on to my fellow board members, and then we certainly will pass it on to the public. The 21st century kind of idea, and I see it at the middle high school with the library and what we're proposing there. Maybe I missed it, but is there something being done at Cottle to kind of create that same type of environment? I know they're younger children, and their needs might be a little bit different. But can you kind of share with me maybe a little bit more in detail how we're going to make Cottle have some sort of new sort of learning?
The library is expanded forward and the entire area is to be renovated.
Okay.
So it would get a similar update. Exactly what that means would be the subject of a lot further discussion and design.
Okay, great. I guess I'll start off. Why don't we start with the non-committee members, so Michelle and Danielle.
Okay, I also want to thank all the committee members who worked on this project. I am pro-committee, I'm committees for committees, so thank you everyone for your contributions and for all your help with this. I do have a lot of questions. This is the first time I'm seeing this. So one thing I wanted to know is, do we have the cost itemized? So do we have, let's say, the cost, I know you brought out the cost of the auditorium and turf and Cottle Field. But is there a separate cost for, let's say, the gymnasium, the canopies, things like that? Is that all broken out by cost?
Yes.
Okay. Can we see that?
I don't have that detail to present.
Okay.
I mean, that's how we came to these numbers.
Okay.
But there's a complete cost estimate for every single line item, and we'll be happy to share that.
And
but I would also point out that these are just budgets at this time. This is a concept and a budget. So.
Okay.
It'd be more
earlier in the presentation when you talked about enrollment and capacity, and I just want to make sure I understand it correctly, how the enrollment is increasing at Cottle. So obviously the capacity is we don't have enough capacity. But I thought the chart that you showed was the enrollment and the capacity in the middle school and the high school were equal at this, as of right now?
At the target when we get there, the 10-year target.
Oh, when we get there. So right. So right now there is capacity.
Very little capacity at the high school, yes.
Well, if I understood it right, Cottle is above capacity.
Way above.
And we're making do with what we have.
So yeah.
The ideal capacity is not there.
Right.
As it stands right now.
Right.
That's the art on a card.
What I'm asking is what happens as the enrollment, as these students get to the high school, middle school, with the changes that I'm seeing, I don't see additional classroom space in the middle school and the high school. And even with moving the district offices, I see just additional art classes because of the work being done in the auditorium. Is there a need for more class? Will there be a need for more classrooms in the middle school and the high school with the increased enrollment?
And no, because the capacity in enrollment was for 10 years from now. The enrollment was compared to the capacity today and the enrollment in 10 years, which will be higher.
Okay, so right now we have room for more students in the middle school.
A little
school.
Bit, yeah.
Okay,
I was going to say you want to.
No, well, I'm not sure. When you say a little bit, I don't know.
Well, I haven't done that analysis. Again, you plan capital projects for your high school in 10 years from now, mm-hmm. and your K-5 building 5 years, because the state really wants you to be looking forward, not solving just your problem for this year.
Danielle?
Go ahead. Excuse me, sorry to interrupt. Our AV person is asking that board members speak into the mic very closely so we can pick you up and have you on camera.
Say hello.
Testing. Okay, so I want to just thank everybody who worked on this, because clearly it was a lot of work and it's a lot to take in all at once, so I'd ask if this will be online for people to see.
I'm going to go over some things. It will be online. I'll read some points out as we get through this.
And a question I did have was, you mentioned air conditioning on the upper levels of the middle high school. Does this plan account for air conditioning being through Cottle?
Only in the new second floor.
Only the new up.
Right.
Will it be set up so that if it wanted to be included, added after, it would be easier?
Well, I mean, I should say it would be the new district office, it would be the new second floor, but we're not renovating every classroom in Cottle as part of this program, so there is no provision for air conditioning in the rest of it. The spaces that we're renovating, like the district office, the library, where we're converting the gymnasium, will be able to accommodate air conditioning, but not all the existing classrooms that aren't being renovated.
Robert Dodge, I mean, I know you've been involved in the process. Do you have any questions or comments, maybe?
My only question is about the air conditioning. I know the high school on the third floor does have a problem with the air conditioning. Is there a way to include into this budget something that could be done with that third floor?
Well, we have an allowance in the number right now, which we believe to be adequate. And our engineering team is analyzing that right now. So within the next week or two, we'll have that number confirmed.
Good, thank you.
Again, I'd just like to thank everybody for coming out tonight. It's been a long process. There's been many things discussed by the committee. I'd like to thank the committee members and everybody involved. I think this is a lot to digest. I think someone said that earlier. I think what's important is that everybody who's here, thank you again for coming, and think about this and provide us feedback. I think we're at a position and a time right now where there is an opportunity. Money is cheap right now, and I think that needs to be taken into consideration. I'm a taxpayer like everybody here, I'm sure, and definitely will feel this for sure. So I think people need to think about that, how it affects their children, the community, their home values, and take all that into consideration and think of what we're doing for our children. I think there's been a lot of change in this community over the years, and I think there's a commitment by all of us as taxpayers to live here, and we made that choice. And I think some of these things are very important for the direction of the school, where we're headed, what we're trying to accomplish, if we're going to keep our kids in district, not keep them in district. So I think there's a lot of things to be weighed here. So I would just like everybody to not get too excited or get their head over their skis over the cost. This is why we're having discussion.
I think we could talk about a lot of different things. I think there was a lot of effort put into this, and I just want to make sure people, you know, don't get too overly excited tonight, and think about this hard and come to us. We're all reachable. You know how to find us all, and that's why we're opening the mic tonight, and we want to talk about this and make sure we get it right. We think this is a good opportunity, and we want to make sure it's handled properly.
So that's a good transition, and then we're going to go to community questions, and even if there's some staff here that want to ask some questions. So our next opportunity for discussion about this capital plan will be at the next workshop that we have December 5th. So those of you who are here would like to come in person, who are watching online or will be watching the repeat on television again, December 5th at 7:30, there will be a board workshop where we'll rediscuss this again. Any residents who do not have children in the district and wish to receive emails to stay apprised of all the related upcoming discussions can again sign up at our community email list, and a form on how to do that is on our website at tuckahoeschools.org. So I want to make sure that non-school member folks, or if you have neighbors that aren't in the school district, let them know to go to the website. We're not trying to hide this from people who aren't in the school district. This is a community decision. And that's under the announcement section on the website as well. So tell your neighbors if you're watching or here in person. We really do encourage resident feedback. So what I don't want this to seem is that we're pushing an agenda on the community. I always remind people that as board members, we're community members, and that's why we're on the board. And we're representatives of everybody in the school district in a small way. So please give us your feedback as much as you'd like. If you're unable to attend any of these live discussions, whether it be tonight or December 5th or any further meetings, we still want to hear what you have to say. So what we've done is set up an email that'll be live within 24 to 48 hours in total. And the email is capitalproject@tuckahoeschools.org. That information will also be on the website. So you can just go to the Tuckahoe Schools. You don't have to worry about how to spell the website or how to write it out or how many words are in there. And we won't be able to respond to every single email if we get like 500 emails, but they will be read. And what we discussed today is that if we get a lot of questions that are similar, and we take a look at it after a couple of weeks and we kind of go through these things, we might just put out an FAQ based on some of the more common questions that are coming in. And if we don't get a lot of feedback, then you'll probably get a direct response from the district. The other thing is that the email addresses and all the presentations that are discussed tonight will be posted on our website tomorrow morning on the homepage. So everything will be, if you go to tuckahoeschools.org, you'll be able to get that doorway into all the information about the capital improvement plan. So I just want to put that out there because there are people that are watching at home, probably more than are here right now, and will be watching on the repeat. We might want to solicit feedback from you. But with that, if my fellow board members agree, what I'd like to do is open it up to questions, comments, concerns. There's a microphone over there. I just ask that you just come up and speak into the microphone as a common courtesy. We always ask people to just tell us your name and tell us where you live so that we know who you are. And again, nothing's been decided yet, so we definitely welcome some of the questions or comments that you may have. And the reason why I say speak into the microphone, because people won't hear us at home if we can talk from the audience.
Hi, my name is Nathan Jackman. I'd like to thank everyone for their work on this. I really appreciate that it's a thank list.
Just slide that mic up.
Thank you. I just want to thank you guys. I know it's a thankless job, and you guys put a lot of hours in. I really appreciate it. I, for one, am perfectly fine with spending a lot of money on the district. The cost doesn't scare me. However, I have some concern about the strategic vision that's going on here in that we talk a lot about this 21st century education. I don't think the priority in the 21st century education is a giant two-story gym for elementary students. It seems that we are prioritizing things related to sports here, which I'm fine with. Sports are great. I wonder why the previous gymnasium was not good enough for these children, not better use could not be made of what I think looks like a fantastic facility being put in the field. I mean, this could hold God knows how many classrooms. We mentioned a STEM class, that would be available in the elementary school. Where is that actually supposed to be on this plan?
It's in a portion of the former gymnasium.
Okay, so you're taking the gymnasium. We have a small gymnasium in there, and then there's going to be a STEM class and an art class.
And half of it will remain as a play space for the youngest children.
Okay, thank you. And then the gymnasium itself, this two-story facility with, you know, it looks like an amazing place, but is this specifically for the elementary school and for the elementary students? Or is this for the high school as well?
Was the committee's thinking that it's really a community asset? The fact that the middle school and high school share one gym, that, and when you have extracurricular programs, you're really strapped for space, that it would really be a district-wide asset. But the thinking was during the school day, the older children would use it from coddle.
Okay. I have my concerns whether or not, again, I have no problem with the money, but a auditorium, a gymnasium, and some fancy new offices for the district don't seem to me to be a good expenditure of the funds that we're talking about here. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, Beth Ann Silvestri, Gifford Street. So I think you just answered my question. So this new gym space will be rentable space for the community or not rentable?
Well, that's really up to the board. It's a separate facility, so it could be used for any variety of purposes, yes.
Okay. I actually like the gym space. And the other question, it piggybacks on what Stephen said. You talked about the security going into the district office, but I actually didn't hear, and maybe you did say, but I didn't hear it, security going into the front door of Cottle. Will that be a revised space?
Yeah, there's a little expansion of the front entrance, so there'd be a new separate security office and a secure vestibule on the front of the building.
Okay. So will that, those two classrooms that you walk into, will they be there?
There's still classrooms there, but there's a whole stage in front of that.
Okay.
So that you can't get in there without physically going through two sets of doors and talking to a security person.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, Gary, I'm getting texts from my wife that they can't hear some of us, so maybe some more coming. My phone's buzzing like crazy, like something wrong.
Hello. Good evening. My name is Joey Amato. You guys are great. Board, you guys are awesome. When I made the decision to move up to Westchester County from the Bronx, I chose Tuckahoe for a particular reason. I went to almost all the school districts closer to the city, as well as up to Briarcliff Manor and in and around that area. And the only reason why I chose to move here was because of the school district, because I had two children and whatnot. And it was because of the, not only the appearance of it, coming from the Bronx, I'm in a very tight area. And when I saw driving by Siwanoy and seeing the horse stable fence and seeing that beautiful drive, and then you had the nature preserve and the dog park, which I take advantage of with my family, I looked at this school facility and I saw how it was the only school district where you had a middle school and a high school close to the grammar school. You don't see that anywhere. You just don't see that. They gotta be bused and moved around. So my concern is, again, like that gentleman, not the money aspect, because I own two businesses, one in East Chester and one in Tuckahoe, so I'm all for this community. When I say I moved up here, I moved my businesses here as well. My concern is the space that's going to be taken away from the field, because that was a nice wide open space. Now all of a sudden it's gone. So, you know, in a time when there's a lot of building going on, everybody's rah-rah, building, but what happened to like some space and land? So I'm more concerned with that because that looks a little crowded to me. So it's kind of almost the adverse reaction of how I felt when I first moved up here. So that's more of my main concern. I agree with moving towards the 21st century, whatever that means, but at the same token, I'm looking at it from more of that perspective. And what's this second building over there? There's two blue. So I see the one to the right.
That's just the second story.
Oh, that's the second floor.
It just fits on top. Yeah.
So then how close is that to the field, the present baseball field, softball field that's there?
It's about the same. Right now there's a playground right here.
Yeah, so the playground that's presently there is going to be obviously gone.
It's going to be sort of incorporated into this area that we showed those sketches of. So this building isn't really taking away field space. It's a rocky outcropping and a portion of the playground.
And what's the square footage?
Of the building? I don't have that. I can get it for you, but.
The other question I have is that the individuals who are in this building right now, the board or the people that are going to be moving into that new building, what's the square footage in this building that's going to be used to put more classrooms according to what someone informed me, because I came a little late? So there's the square footage in this building presently right now for the district members?
Yeah,
or
I don't have those numbers memorized, but I can give them. I can get them to you.
Well, get them to us. Yeah, that'd be cool.
That's fine.
I appreciate that.
Sure.
And again, you guys are doing a great job, and you know, I love this community, and I only want the best for it. But at the same token, I like the space, open space. So maybe if there's a way to do it somewhere else in that building and go higher, God bless America.
Well, Mr. Amato, one thing that we will be gaining that we don't have now that we've been actively discussing is Salinoy Boulevard, which is the street there, would actually be converted into more park space. So while we might lose a little slither of the park-like setting that we have, the playground, we would gain that strip right now, just a street, which may make the school actually look nicer from a playgroundish area. But you know, it's hard to tell when you're looking at pictures from a computer. But just an idea that we don't have now that we will have.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. If I got something else, I could come back up.
Sure.
Is that going to be used as an auditorium space?
We were asked how many people could fit in there if you put seats on the floor. So it could be used for that type of thing, and it has a big capacity, yes.
Okay, only because if that were the case, then is anything going to happen with the current auditorium that's at Cottle? Is it just going to end up sitting dormant there? Is no one going to use it?
Well, I think it would still be there, and it would still be the primary auditorium for small events in Cottle for the younger kids. I think that the thinking of the new gym was if you wanted to have a larger gathering, because you don't have that capacity either in this room today or in your current gym.
Okay. And on paper it looks like a great facility, but we're strapped for parking. Did anyone think of that? Like, where's, and especially now at night, we get to park along Siwanoy. Once you close up that street, how many cars are gonna just not be able to park there? I mean, they park up and down that street at any type of an event. So that's a big concern. But that still limits it down to one lane, and I don't think you're going to be able to block that up. So you're really losing all of your parking up and down Siwanoy, which we were here, I don't know if you guys were here for the Halloween party, and there was cars parked up and down both sides. Cars cannot get through. If you have someone coming up the road, you can't get down. So it's narrow to begin with, and if you're going to expand the park area out onto Siwanoy, you're losing already a lane of traffic, and then you're closing it off. Well, you still have to leave room. So that's a big problem. I mean, we already have a big problem with parking, especially having the district office coming down. There's no parking there in the morning. I drop off my son at 8 o'clock in the morning, and there's no parking already. So let alone an event going on where you're going to be able to put over 1,000 people into this new gym facility, where's everyone parking?
That's a good question.
And our streets are not big. I mean, you guys live around the area. You know what it's like. Mm-hmm. On a game day, over by the high school, same issue.
I think it's a legitimate question. You only have so much of a footprint, you know, and I hear you. It's not ideal. I don't know the answer.
Is there any provision for parking in this plan? Is there any additional parking or designated parking?
The only thing we talked about was the possibility of using a portion of Siwanoy at times for parking. But as you mentioned, there's just no footprint. I mean, it was a lot of discussion, and everybody acknowledges that it's a challenge, but there's just no land.
Okay.
What about the space behind Cottle?
We did look at that, and we had a survey done to confirm, because we were hoping there was a little more room back mm-hmm. here, but there isn't. Mm-hmm. And even right now, I think your garbage collection is done here. There was mm-hmm. talk about could we expand back here.
Yeah.
And the way your garbage is done, that might get you 3 or 4 spaces maybe at most. So it's we can continue to look, but you're just very short on available land.
Is anything being changed on the front circle in Cottle, the front circle area?
There wasn't a proposed change there, no.
Oh, okay. I just wasn't sure if I was looking at it right or not.
Yeah.
It just maybe the way it looks.
No, that would remain.
But now the district offices, are they going at the top of the hill? Is that going to be a new addition, or is it where like 4th and 5th grade currently are?
It's where 4th and 5th grade currently are.
Okay, so you're going to just build up on top of that? Is that
right.
The idea of it?
Right. We just felt that the district office should be on the ground level so people can come in and leave easily.
Okay. And if you know off the top of your head, what is the estimated cost on that gym facility?
I can look at our detailed cost estimate and get back to you on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'd rather more go into library, media, that type of thing. I mean, this plan is going, it's a 5-year for Cottle and like 10 for the high school, middle school,
right.
High school. Is that what you had said?
That's the planning threshold. That's the enrollment that you plan for, right?
Okay, so we're talking 10 years at this point. But this project is not going to be done, completed in what, about 3 years?
3 years, yeah.
So we're already losing 3 years of the 5 for Cottle. So maybe we need to look further into that. You're losing your first 3 years just on building.
Well, you're absolutely right. That's a very good observation. The issue isn't that we shouldn't look forward. It's that the state only supports funding for a 5-year enrollment projection in grades K through 5. Because in order to project enrollments further than that, you have to guess how many children are going to be born, and no one's any good at that.
Right. No, I understand that. I mean, we have some large buildings that were built down in Tuckahoe, so we don't know what's coming in with that as well.
Right.
So even if it's a young couple and
theoretically, those were taken into account when your enrollment projection was done.
Okay. Okay.
Thanks.
That's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mic up. All right, Harry Hall, 77 Middle Road. So I wasn't going to bring up parking right away, but I might as well. So parking's been a big issue already. You're going to build a 1,000-seat structure, and you've already impacted our quality of life pretty badly on Middle Road with the traffic study and the way things have gone. So just from that point of view. You gotta really, if you're gonna put this gym up, you have to really think about what you're gonna do about traffic flow, parking, et cetera, because it's just not, come down my street on a Sunday and see what it's like. You know, it's not, you can't navigate it. And I know that, people park illegally, parking on the grass, it's just, it can't be done. So, I really gotta do something about that. But I have some more questions regarding this, and I wrote them down when I wasn't wearing my glasses, so I don't know if I can read them. All right. So if we do put the gym up there, where's TASC going to go? Right? TASC has sort of been one of the greatest things that this school offered my son was the TASC program. And the TASC program got kicked out of the gym because of class size, et cetera. And now I want to know where TASC is going to go when you take away that little playground area that they have, because now the gym's there and they can't play on the softball field because the kids are either practicing football or they're playing, or they're playing softball there. And so then where do the TASC kids go? Or is TASC just disappearing?
Thanks for your point, Harry. I think certainly the TASC program would still have space and will be allocated space. It would have to be. I mean, I'm involved there, and you're 100% right. It's an integral part of the community. So I think part of the proposal with Simon Lloyd Boulevard is that would be closed, so we'd pick up some space there for park space. The playground would also be relocated to another area on the field. So you're right, there are other, I mean, that's part of what the concerns are. There's not enough space for all of our children. So you're right, we'd have to come up with an idea, and maybe we can get some involvement from the community or suggestions of what we could do to make sure there is play space for children who are not involved in athletics on that field. But hopefully we will pick up a fair amount of space with the street being closed.
It's not that wide a street. So that's that. Who do you plan on having use the gym? The gym is rentable space. You know, I'm concerned about what's going to happen to the gym, just as like what happened to the field here. The field here was supposed to be used, we were promised that it was only going to be used by Tuckahoe schools. It's been used by everything. So, you know, the field is falling apart, and now you got to rebuild, you know, you have to redo it. So how much is that gym going to be utilized? I'm not liking this gym, I have to say. How much is it going to be utilized? How is it going to impact this part of the community? You know, how big is it going to be? How tall is it going to be?
The inside height needs to be about 25 feet. So when you add structure to that, it'll be about 30 feet tall. So about the same as a two-story house.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then awning will be about the same height?
Awning will be lower. You need like 13 feet clear under the awning, so that's be more like 50.
Because this is a neighborhood too, you know, and you're putting another structure in this neighborhood that we live in, you know.
Again, it's a proposal, and the committee recommended this option. There's a lot of discussion to happen. The gym would also be sort of cut into the hill, so it would be about 30 feet tall on the low side, and on the high side, it's going to be about half that high.
Yeah, and I'm worried about it getting overused, just like I'm worried about what happened with that with the field over there. Now, this is going to be about a 5% or maybe a little bit more increase in our taxes. So that doesn't include increasing in staffing. You're going to have more classrooms. You're going to have to increase staffing. You need to increase staffing anyway. My child still has over 30 kids in one of his classes. This is something that's been a common occurrence for him for the last like 5 years. So, you know, I have to ask you, then, if you proudly say we stay under the tax cap, and you're going to have to try, you know, if you're going to try and sell this 5% increase in our sales tax, in our property tax, our school tax, I should say, how are you going to staff those rooms? How are you going to reduce our class sizes to those ideal numbers that he was talking about, 20, which they're not?
Well, certainly if there's enrollment increases, we have to increase our staff. That would be whether or not we do an improvement project or not.
Right, but you're going to try and sell them both. You know, so you're going to try and sell the community a 5% increase on their school taxes for this capital improvement. And I'm not saying I don't think it should be done. You know, I'm not sold on the gym, but I think that we need to increase college school. But then you're also going to have to sell the community on increasing the taxes because you're going to have to hire more teachers. So how are you going to sell them both?
The portion of the taxes that are devoted to staff would have to increase if we do have an increase in enrollment. So that would go without saying. But for some of the other costs that might be involved, we're hoping that there will be energy efficiencies and the infrastructure upgrades that will pay for some of the other costs involved in maintaining a larger plant, physical plant. But staff increases would happen regardless. That would have to happen enrollment increases. Yeah.
But then I don't see how you're going to, like, I think that you have this great plan, it's so huge, you're going to try and sell this, what I'm trying to say is you're trying to sell a 5% increase, and then you're going to, on top of that, increase the taxes more than you have in the last couple of years, because instead of getting rid of staffing, you're going to have to hire staffing. So how's that going to work?
If there's a need for increased staff, it wouldn't be all at once as well.
Come on, comment. Go ahead.
Just to mention, just to mention, we talked about increased staff. In the 5 or 6 years that I've been at Connell, we've had 24 teachers retire at top salary, replaced them with 25 teachers at a reduced salary. So right there, there was over $1 million, if not more, in savings. And remember, new students brings in new state aid. So bottom line is that we have five kindergarten, five first grades, five second grades, but four third, fourth, and fifth grades. So we are definitely in that second addition would add three more classes, plus a science lab, and then, like you said, taking the classes that are downstairs, bringing them up to make office space. But you're really talking three more teachers. But remember, we already replaced them with 25 teachers at probably about half the salary. So that was one savings that the taxpayers have already seen.
I guess my son's been unlucky. What can I say? All right. Well, again, then I just want to express my displeasure with the gym. I just think that needs to be rethought.
Thank you, Harry.
Hi. I just want to ask a couple of numbers. What did you say was the total debt service on this project?
After the reduction for state aid, it would be $2.1 million per year.
Okay, so 2.1 for 15 years?
15 years.
At what rate?
2%.
Is it a fixed rate?
It varies, but it fluctuates by about 0.1. So it goes from about 1.9 to 2.1, depending on the coupon rate. And that's just an estimate based on today.
No. What I'm saying is it a fixed rate
basically,
for the
15-year yes.
term?
Mm-hmm.
So if the interest rates go up to 10% again,
it would not go up.
It goes up. Okay. Yeah. And then also, you came up with a figure of $935 per what was that, per household?
It's for the typical assessed value home in Tuckahoe,
okay,
which is
so
about $8,500 assessed value.
Okay, so that $935, on that typical assessed value, what is the property tax or the school tax on that house that would be paying the extra $935?
About $12,175.
For the property or the school?
School only.
So school tax. So that would be about, we pay about 70% of our taxes that go to the school, so that would be about $17,000 for a house that pays about $17,000 in property taxes, right?
Well, I don't know the rest of the tax.
Yeah, well, that's what it would be, about $17,000.
That calculation is correct.
Okay, so we have to put it into perspective because a lot of people are paying $20,000, $25,000, $30,000 or more.
Mm-hmm.
So that was it. So my main question was whether or not the debt would be fixed. I know how RANs and TANs work, but this is a note, wouldn't it? This is a 15-year note.
Right, but it would be fixed.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thanks. Good evening. Lenny Caraturo, 49 North Way. I got a quick question. Oh, this is, you know, a big, you know, 5 to 10% increase in your taxes, and it's like a 5 to 10% increase in your taxes. And I think the focus here is on the enrollment. So we're using terms like surging and this and that, but what are the actual numbers? Because, you know, we might be in the cycle, and what happens when the cycle goes down? Now we have all these empty rooms. So was it like a 10-year study, 20-year study, 30-year study? How long has the study gone on as far as enrollment?
So the enrollment projection is only as good as the data that you can base it on. And we didn't do it, but we do interpret them, so I'm trying to answer your question. So again, for grades K through 5, they find that 5 years is adequate and reliable. And high school, it goes out 10 years. Because in a high school kid, a 12th grader has been around 10 years. So they use historical, what's called migration ratios, how many people go from first to second, second to third, third to fourth, and those are developed over many, many years. And they use the number of kids in the system and the number of live births in Tuckahoe to come up with these numbers. But there's always been demographic fluctuations, so going beyond 10 years is just not that reliable, and that's why the state doesn't really support.
But what are the actual figures? So 3 years ago, there's 120 kids in a senior class.
Well, I'm sure.
Well, how many kids are in a Cottle class right now?
I'm sure the district can give you a copy of their enrollment study.
But wouldn't that be like a major point to address? Like, because, and then do they factor in K kids going to a Catholic school, what do they actually reduce the from the to the fifth grade to the middle school? What was the reduction of kids leaving the school?
Right. So that's called the migration ratio, and they look at the history of the district. So if you had a parochial school that typically took a lot of fourth graders away when they went to fifth grade, that would be factored into the enrollment study.
Okay. This is just my point. We're talking about factoring and surging and all this, but what is an actual number? Is it 50? Is it 55 kids? What is the actual numbers?
I memorized the district's enrollment projections, so you can get a full set of them. And
does anybody have an idea?
So what I would say is Cottle is busting at the scene.
Okay, busting is great. What does that mean? How many kids?
We're using space that really wasn't intended for classrooms. We're getting to the point right now where if it grows just a little bit more, we're going to have to put mobile classrooms out.
It's terrific, but what is an actual figure?
643 students.
Okay. What do we have?
As of today.
What do we have 5 years ago?
Probably around, I don't have off the top of my head, but probably 520, 530.
Okay, so 100 kids more, 8 classes, 20 kids enrollment each year. So you're asking to increase our tax bill 10% over 20 kids per class per year, a $10 million gym, that's 30% of the budget probably, for 20 kids per year per class. That's why I think these figures on enrollment are important, and we should have them pinpointed down, not talking about surging and this and that. What are the actual numbers so we can grab and understand what we're talking about? Maybe we'll have them at the next December 5th. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Mr. Mann.
How you guys doing? Again, great job, all these. I dig what that guy just said. I dig that. And the families really got to consider that once this goes up, all the families got to consider this. Now, I pay well over 20. So what the families got to consider is that once it goes up, it's never going down, no matter what you think. Once it goes up, good night. I gotta go.
Hi, my name is Stanley Shi. I want to start off by thanking the architectural firm for putting in a lot of work, also the exploratory committee as well as the Board of Education. I'm sure a lot of work went into the preliminaries on this. I have one specific question and then one kind of more general question and comment. So the first thing is, if you could please put on the diagram for Cottle. I do have a specific question about that. One of the commenters before, I think, had a good point. You had a 5-year projection, but it's going to take 3 years to complete this. So I just want to know about a contingency plan on the... I think you had it. I think you just passed it. But yeah, right there. So you have the conversion of part of the first floor on the hill over there to administrative, the district administrative offices, correct?
Yep.
And then a floor on top. Just for future proofing, if there's more of an increase of students at Cottle, could those first floor administrative offices be easily converted to extra classrooms so that we don't have to put on additional funding and bonds for an additional expansion 5 or 10 years down the road on something that's being financed for 15 years already?
Absolutely. And by the way, that would be the last thing that would take place. So it would be, you would have those classrooms in use while everything else is going on.
Okay. Another is a more general comment. It's probably something that's coming already, I think, and I'm sure it's maybe something I'm reading into, but the plan looks really kind of logical and kind of like there's pieces, okay? There's like the high school infrastructure, then there's a high school auditorium, then there's the gym that's standalone here on the Cottle Field, then it's basically mostly the renovation in Cottle is just that wing on the hill and the extra story and administrative offices. So that's kind of, to me, that's compartmentalized. And then, you know, maybe a little renovation on the lunchroom side there by the entrance where people get checked in when they come in. And then, of course, there's the kind of the modification of the roadway, and then just kind of looks like minor modification of the existing gym. Is that a pretty good summary of what's going on?
The library is also being expanded.
The Cottle Library?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Well, in any case, it seems like, so some of these are kind of like, it's kind of like Lego pieces. So I'm sure this is coming up, but it would seem like a good idea to kind of break everything out, because obviously a proposal like this is not all or nothing. If, you know, it's correct me if I'm wrong, I'd like to know, you know, if maybe some phases, you know, definitely are cost effective to do kind of all at once, or, you know, certain things look to be completely separate. So just to take a simple example, I know at least one gentleman here would like to hear this, but, you know, it looks like everything could be done except for the gym, let's say. It looks like that would be a possibility. Or, for example, in the high school, the infrastructure can be taken care of, but we could, if we had to, leave the auditorium alone or with minor, you know, upgrades. Would that be kind of an accurate statement, or am I misunderstanding?
Well, I think we heard that from the board, too, and we have this, and we'll, I think, at the next meeting, be happy to sort of break it down for everybody, sure.
Right. So it looks like, that seems like a reasonable possibility. This isn't an all or nothing thing. You know, that's a big number that you put up, but, you know, I think, you know, maybe we can compromise
I'll make one comment.
Yeah.
What we're proposing, we're not proposing anything here. What we're showing you is what a committee came up with, a suggestion that, quite honestly, is the first time I'm seeing it as a board member this evening. Right. Any part of this project could be decided not to be presented for a vote. So, but the one thing that's important for everybody to understand is there has to be a budget for a bond that is voted on, whether it's all-encompassing or the board members, the five of us, along with our superintendent, based on public feedback, decide certain parts of this bond are a no-go by the public. And that's why we're asking for feedback from the community. So we've heard some people say they like the gym, some people have said they don't like the gym, and as we go further into this process and we hear certain departmentalized ideas, like you say, we can make an informed decision on what we want to put out to vote at that point, and the community has to vote for it. So we might come to a conclusion based on what the community says that they want X, and we put it out to vote, and 70% of people say no. We don't know. We're not making any decisions as the five of us. We are not going to say this is what we're doing. This is going to be a community decision. And what we're trying to get at is what people are feeling. And we've definitely heard differences of opinions, but I agree with you. There is departmentalized. The problem is that we can't, as a board, say, oh, we'll give you this choice, or this choice, vote on one. That's not the way it'll work. It'll be, this is the suggestion that we come up with. Yes or no?
Could I just add to that? Has a priority list been established? Like, obviously, the additional classrooms at Cottle, the security measures, the infrastructure measures, but has the committee or have the administrators established a list of priorities?
Well, as the facilitator of the committee process, there was several options explored that had lots of different combinations. Mm-hmm. This was the committee recommendation, mm-hmm. But we can reverse engineer it back to the many different things, and if you want the committee to prioritize it, that would be up to you folks.
My turn. Tony Bonacore, that little white box you see on the thing, that's my house. And none of my comments have anything to do with the proximity in my house to this project, because when I first moved here, the first extension on Cottle on the end was tennis courts. And I moved in and I said, look, I got beautiful tennis courts. A year later, it was the extension on Cottle, so, which was a great thing. But I truly appreciate, I was on the board 15 years and went through many capital projects, and the job that these guys are gonna have to do with this, it's difficult. It's a stressful job, and to sit there and have to take into account every stakeholder group in this district, whether you have kids, you're gonna have kids, or like me, my kids went through the district, or you're senior citizens, every one of those stakeholder groups, you're gonna have to take input from and weigh into this decision. I'm on the committee, and just some of the things I was listening, the gym, if you look at the Cottle gym now and the high school gym now, to me, It's almost going to be a flip-flop when you talk about after-school usage. After-school usage, I think the high school gym will become more of the modified JV teams, and this gym will be more of the varsity gym. Correct me if anybody thinks I'm wrong there, where you'll see the basketball team, the varsity teams play their games here. I don't think it's strictly being presented to be, you know, a big community gym for the community that's going to be used for rentals, where everybody's going to be using it. I think it's going to be fully utilized like this gym is for varsity. And then, like I said, it's going to be a flip-flop. You can see all the JV and modified be using this gym and wherever other groups, cheerleading, whatever. I also think we talked about in between the gym and I guess that first house, you're going to try to put parking there was a possibility. That was in the plan. And listening to the task comment, maybe it's a possibility it's where a playground could be instead, you know, because the one thing that I've been adamant about and people have talked about is Samonoy closing that street. I'm so against closing that street. I think it should be closed like it used to be from 8 in the morning to 6 at night, locked off, and then from 6 to 8, and on the weekends in the summer, that street should be opened and used for the community because it's the widest street just about in Bronxville Manor. When you talk about emergency vehicles, large trucks and everything, that's where everybody goes. If you want to try to funnel all that traffic up middle, you're going to crucify all these people who live on middle where there's no room as it is over there. So that's just my two cents about that street where I think it should remain a usable street, but closed off, of course, during the day when kids are in use. Cottlefield, I see that about the possible turfing. I think that field just has to be completely done over, dug up, and planted grass. Because when you put the turf on, you have to be able to secure the field. The high school field at least has some security because of the height of the fences, and everybody just can't get on there and do what they want. But Cottle's so much more accessible. If you're going to put a turf there, you're going to have to put high fences to keep everybody from whether they're walking their dogs or when the snow comes, they get out there with snowmobiles. You have to protect it somehow. So I think regrading that whole field and putting the grass down properly again, maybe some sprinkler system will be the way to go there. The administrator, you talk about if the administrator office, if Cottle capacity grew, yeah, you can make those with the classroom. Now you got to move the administrative offices somewhere again. So there's going to be a cost involved with that. The project, I think, you know, it comes down to, I guess, we talk about needs versus wants. You know, we do need the capacity. Putting that second level on Cottle, it's across the street from my house, but you have to do it. And when that extension was put there, it was built with that purpose. There's footings on there, so you can put a second level on there. So I think that is really necessary. That has to be done. I think the administration moving out is essential, too, because you got to make room in the high school because this capacity at Cottle is going up to the high school eventually, so you're going to need that space up there. The other part, the needs versus wants, where we're going to have to battle and wiggle out is, you know, this auditorium, restoring it to what it was, which I never saw what it was, and I've been here 25 years. My wife tells me about it, but, you know, that's a want. Do you want to put it completely back to that, or is there a modification of that? The gym, that's another story where you listen to all the comments on everybody. It's a big part of this. It's one-third of this budget. So there's going to be a lot of input about the gym. But I still think it's not a space that's a wasted space. It's really going to become more of the, you know, the Cottle kids in the daytime can use it. And I think it'll become the varsity space because of the size of it and the capacity you could put there. That's what it'll turn into, I think, after school. What else? I had so many things running through my head with this because I've been through so many of these projects. Again, the biggest thing is looking at the all the stakeholder groups. You know, a lot of people say $1,000. Like for me, it's probably $1,100 a year increase it'll be. And you know, it's a chunk of change. If you're on fixed income, whether you don't get raises, you know, and we see how it scales down. But in reality, with someone says. As the motto said, your rent is not going to go down. I mean, the number may get less, but there's always something else that gets an increase here and there. So your tax increase, your tax rate is never going to change and drop. You know, it's always and it's a big number. So I really appreciate what the board's going to have to go through with this because it's going to be tough, and you're going to get so many comments and a lot of advice. So good luck with it, and I'm sure we're going to have a lot more meetings. And I know I have a lot more things in my head, but we'll see for another time. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony.
Good evening. Mike Denning, 72 Stebbins. Thank you to the board for all you've done. Lisa, I know you've been here the longest, right, on the board, all the years you're serving, right? A few comments. I agree with closing Saiwanoy. Excuse me, closing Saiwanoy is not a great idea. It is for emergency vehicles to get through. I know there's a meandering lane that's going to be there. But besides that, I know in Connell there is, I think Vast, and Pete would know better, Vast basement space in Connell, right? In parts of Connell, there's some big space in the basement. It's kind of nobody wants to have an office in a basement, but listen, we got to find space where we can pop a window in and air conditioning, whatever. Yeah, the kindergarten wing. So there's a decent amount of space there. We could use the basement for offices if we needed to. So right now it's storage. Okay. Then as far as the chimney, we're talking about repointing the chimney here on the school here. If we're going to replace the boilers anyway, you're going to replace the boilers, you go to a high condensing boiler where it's direct vent, and you don't need to repoint that chimney, just take that chimney down. So there'll be a cost in taking it down, but it won't have to be repointed again in another 20 years. And also reaching out to Con Edison about getting incentives for new boilers and for LED lighting, upgrade the lighting in the school. I did it in our commercial building, and it was $1,250. I couldn't buy the light bulbs for that. And they came in and redid all the fixtures through Con Ed. Yeah, and you got to turn the heat down. Everybody in Connell says that. You got to turn the heat down. You know, kids wear shorts and T-shirts, and they come outside. Set the heat at Connell at 62 degrees. The body heat that comes in with all the kids, the room temperature will come up naturally. You don't need to have it at 68 or 78, whatever it is in there. It's stifling. We'll save money on fuel, which will offset. And getting to the money aspect, as far as current outstanding bonds, is there a way to refinance, or what rate are we at on the current bonds for the other, or the addition that was done here on this school, and other bonds that you're saying are slowly getting paid off to 2030?
My predecessor did look into refinancing the bonds, and all of them have been refinanced at the lowest possible rate that we were allowed to do by law. So they're all currently at a very low interest rate. Some of them could not be paid off. We have to finish the maturity of the bonds until completion.
Very good. Thank you. Sorry. And the net gain is only 4 classrooms, correct, on doing the addition to Cottle? We're not doing the gym. Let's just assume we're not doing the gym. The net gain is 4 classrooms. The net gain is 4 classrooms then, correct?
The way it's currently configured, yeah, it's a net add of 4.
Okay. And we need how many? Because we have five kindergartens, five first grades,
that's
five.
That's just for the addition.
Right.
This proposal also gets you 2 additional classrooms in the former gym, so that's.
Yeah, but we're not doing the gym. Assume we're not doing the gym.
Okay. Well, that would be a different proposal, and then if you still do the district office and you don't do the gym, your net gain would be 4, which
4
is
classrooms.
Actually not enough.
Sorry.
Which is not enough.
Not enough. Correct. Okay. And that's the intention of this, is to have more room for the growth.
Well, that would be, you're describing a different proposal, which we actually did look at. And in that case, it would be difficult to get the district office in there if you don't do the gym as well.
Okay. And then as far as, I know we're taking over the street, Supervisor Calavita had offered it years ago, but he said that then we would be responsible for the sewer line that runs through there, that now it's a meandering lane. So then there is, you know, maybe gas lines running through there, water lines, that when we do this project and then Con Ed decides, all right, we're updating the service in the area and we're going to come through and rip it all up and put in a new 6-inch gas line right through the project, and they're going to just pave it. They're not going to come back and put brick pavers and meandering stuff like that. So is that a thought process that was added in, and the, you know, the infrastructure of the sewer line, the storm drain line as well? It's in the road.
There would be, have to be more investigation done there, okay. But generally utilities replace the paving in kind.
Okay. And then the walkways you just discussed, canopy, if we go forward and do that, would be advantageous to make those walkways solar panels so you're getting some use out of it besides cover for when it rains. And a 13-foot high cover when it rains, the rain's coming in sideways anyway, you're going to get wet. So, I mean, I don't know if we really need the cover, but.
Right. Well, you know, we were asked to explore the idea of a canopy, so that's what we did. It's okay. Not a must-have. If there's good sun, solar panels might be a nice solution as well, okay. For sure.
Also, did anybody explore temporary trailers for this gentrification of, I know our neighborhood has a big, you know, influx of new kids, but, you know, I have a going on 2-year-old, 10-year-old, 7-year-old. So, you know, stretching out for the next couple of years in this neighborhood, there's not that many old people left. So a few more houses, a few more people coming in, and then, you know, you're going to build this all. We used to have Cooper School in the north end of town for the Eastchester School District. They closed it because enrollment was down. Waverly School, they rented out. Then fast forward, they had to put an addition on Waverly School because the enrollment went back up. So, I mean, it does flow, and doing the 5- and 10-year projection is great, but we have documented at least a 30, 50-year, whatever, 86 years old is the building, history of what the enrollment was, and that kind of ride that wave and see how that worked out. And births in Tuckahoe could be a birth in Tuckahoe, but it's in Crestwood, which is in the Eastchester School District. So we're in a tricky place here where we're in Eastchester, but it's Tuckahoe schools, and people in Tuckahoe may come to Tuckahoe schools or go to Eastchester schools. So to get those numbers, it really needs to be based off of the specific single-family dwellings that you discussed earlier, 12,000 single-family dwellings, or there's co-ops and apartment buildings, but those specific to the district that pay district tax in order to get those numbers. Because as an outside person coming to do consulting, all right, Tuckahoe, here we go, look up Tuckahoe. It's not Tuckahoe. We're Eastchester and Tuckahoe. We're a blend of the two communities into one district.
Well, again, we don't do those.
I understand that. You just interpret them.
I'm interpreting.
Yeah. I'm just in general.
And what they do is they look historically. If there's 100 births in Tuckahoe, no matter where they go to school, and that turns into 20 kindergarten children 5 years ago, they use that ratio.
Okay.
So they know that the birth data doesn't translate 1-to-1. They use a ratio.
Right. And the life expectancy of the field, if you do it a turf field, does anybody know the life expectancy of the turf field?
10 to 12 years, depending on the use.
So let's say it's 10, we're going to do a 15-year bond to do a 10-year field?
Right. More than half the cost of the initial install stays there. You don't replace that.
So there is in this budget replacement cost of the existing turf field here?
Yes.
And what's that rough number?
Around 700.
700, okay. So we'd be back at, let's say that's a smaller field, you'll be back at 500 or 600 for a replacement. That's a 10 years down the road.
Safe guess.
Yeah, without inflation or whatever else. But so you can figure 10 years down the road, you need another 700, and you got to bond that for another 15, and you're paying 5 years of double bond.
Synthetic turf fields, yeah, they don't last.
Right. So I agree with Tony. You get some excavators in there, turn that up, plenty of topsoil, level it out, drainage, sprinkler system, grass. We have enough landscapers in town that could help us out.
Terrific.
And the new playground that Task installed, that's gone. I know you have a play area, but they graciously donated a nice playground that the kids get a use out of. Is that in the plans to move that actual facility, that actual playground?
If the play equipment's movable, it would certainly be reused. Yep.
Yeah, okay. Sorry. All right, and try and reach out to your assemblywoman and senator and ask for a restructuring of, they have to put a bond, excuse me, a piece of legislation up to restructure how the New York State Lottery money is distributed to schools. Our school district gets about $74 per student. Dobbs Ferry gets $650. Yorktown, $900. So we're a little shortchanged. Roxville's 52, Eastchester's 63, 64. But collectively, our three school districts combined in a 30-year history have gotten, I think it's maybe $1 million, $1.5 million. Whereas Yorktown got $3 million last year alone. So reach out to your assemblyman and legislator until we got to make a change. Because Powerball wasn't around when it started, and Mega Millions. And there's a lot more money, the Racinos all over. There's a lot more influx of money into the New York State lottery system. And the formula for distributing the money has not changed in 30 years. So it's time to change the formula, and we need a little restitution for what we've been missing that could pay for some of this. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
I'm afraid it's me again, Nathan Jackman. A couple questions. I'm actually kind of collating some of us over there. One of these is, this says option A on it. I think the unsaid question is, where's option B, C, and D? I think the community would appreciate having some other things to look at rather than just kind of, you know, plopping this down and then we have just one thing to think about. It might be nice to see what other things the committee thought about. Second of all, I'm wondering why there was thought given to a specific second story over that, the new second story structure on Cottle. Was there any discussion on adding more of a second story following the building? So in other words, having a larger second story to contain even more classrooms rather than doing the subdividing of the gym, et cetera?
Well, there's no indication that any other portion of the building was designed to take a second story.
So it involved much more work with footings and everything.
Probably okay. Taking down the first story and starting again, yeah.
Okay, and I'm not sure if anyone here in the room even has any idea, but you know, rumors and innuendo aside, the dog park across the street that's used by the five people a day to play with their precious Labrador. What is the story behind that? Is that owned by Cottle? Was that given to Bronxville? Is it an option for us to look at?
It's owned by Bronxville.
Was it something that we actually gave Bronxville? Because that's the rumor.
No.
Okay. Thank you. And lastly, back to my original question, my real concern here is it feels like there's a certain lack of vision that the big question we keep hearing is Cottle's out of space, we don't have enough space for Cottle, and yet we're adding a net four classrooms, but we're adding a gym, we're adding a $600,000 new turf for a field, we are adding an auditorium, which I'm not sure why we need a 1,000-seat auditorium if this fancy new facility also is going to be our new assembly space for 1,000 people. It's all kind of directed in the wrong directions, and it feels a bit scattershot to me. I'm just at a loss here as to if Cottle's space was the issue, how a gym ended up being the big thing in the room here. That $15 million could build a pretty phenomenal set of classrooms. Anyway, I have concerns. Thank you.
Thank you.
First time we've seen it. So we're here to listen. So if there's concerns, we're hearing it, but we haven't made any decisions on anything yet. And I want to make that very clear because I don't want to think there was an agenda here.
Could I ask the architect, was there opportunity to expand the existing Cottle gym?
There's really not a lot of land there. The property line, I know you have trouble seeing it, but it's only about 8 or 10 feet off the back of the gym. So it's really, really landlocked back there.
All right, Rafael Rivera from 12 Alta Drive. Just to take a step back, a lot of good comments from the audience, but how much is this like we have to do anyway? So when we think about the growth of 5 years and 10 years in the different age groups, how much is this that we're going to have to do it anyway? Because if you're at max capacity, where does it get into safety codes where you can only have so many kids in whatever school building and so forth that went into the planning? Because if...
It's a good question. I didn't interrupt, but I think if you remember, Carl's first slide was, if we do nothing, we're going to have to consider things that are not going to be popular. For example, potentially moving to fifth grade to the middle high school. And then you have to deal with space problems there. There are things that if we do nothing, we're going to have to do things. And
yeah, what I'm thinking, Stephen, is more of a, if you're getting to a point where in 10 years a high school is going to be maxed out from a space point of view, regardless if you move the fifth grade class up, you're going to have to do it anyway, right? You're going to have to do the growth out, right? The same thing in the middle school, the grammar school is going to get to a certain point that the fire department is going to come in, and I'm no safety expert in fires, but it's going to say, okay, you can only have X number of students through steps. X number of students have to exit, and you just maxed out. So a lot of this is almost like, you have to do it anyway because we're going to get there. I mean, we've been talking about this for about 5 or 6 years, and now with the new rentals down at Marbledale Road, it's coming, right? I mean, you know, I was one of the biggest ones protesting it. So the other question is, with respect to the facility or the floor that's going to go above the gym, that potentially go above the gym, is that a good use of a contingency space that when, if we grow more and we need to continue to add more, that it could just fill into that spot, whether, and take advantage of building it now, because if you don't build it now, it always costs more to go back and retrofit something to grow, to expand it. But the second floor, I know it was like for training and so forth, and it is what it is, but is it going to have flexibility that if you need to just turn around and use it to add 4 or 5 more class space, is that an option? Or is that flexible enough to accommodate that?
Yeah, I don't think it's big enough to accommodate that. The second floor of the gym really is just these little spaces here.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm thinking that other blue box is complete, just replica right over the gym.
This is just the upper half of that gym.
Oh, I'm sorry, on that gray area?
So all you really have got is a little corridor to connect the back, the bleachers, and 4 or 5 office spaces.
Okay. And obviously parking was, you know, just one of the big concerns as well. When you're talking about adding that building, is elevating the building more and putting parking space underneath it a possible solution? Underneath the gym.
It's possible. It'd be kind of expensive, but...
So elevation really gets the numbers up.
Yeah, and then it's kind of hard to get to the gym, especially for little kids. You have to... stairs and elevators to get up to the gym.
Okay. And then my last question is, being that the gym is, you know, butting up against, you know, that hill there, was there some consideration of, rather than the building being in the back of the school, almost being in the where home plate is in the home field right on the field right now, so kind of to line up with the facade of the front of the school and then just flip the field the other way, since you're going to redo it anyway, and then you're not butting up so much against the homeowners there, and maybe it just gets away. It's a redesign. You're going to do the field over again anyway. You grass or turf it, but flipping it over and in the other direction, and then that building, if it is built, then becomes sort of like when you drive by by the school, it's just one long school kind of facade looking, rather than having a building, and maybe you don't need the bridge at that point because it's just a facility across, and it eliminates some of the cost potentially. And you get it away from there, and then it keeps it away from the homes as an option. I don't know what it makes it look like that way.
Well, I understand your point, and it could look good over there as well. But because you have sort of an L-shaped space here, you would lose your ability to have a full-size softball field if we flipped it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I always thought that corners, because the corner of center field all the way going back, that's way more than 210 feet.
So, well, we looked at it. You would lose the ability to have a full softball field.
Okay. All right. All right. Thank you.
Unless we call them lefties.
Good point. Good point. Yeah. Okay. That's it. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi, Allison Halloran. I just have a couple of comments. One, I really agree with Tony about keeping Simonoy Boulevard a road that is just closed during the school day and a road that is accessed by the residents of Bronxville Manor when the school is closed. It's, you know, when we have events at the school, it is a road that we do use for parking. And in the summer months when the school is closed, it is a road that residents of Bronxville Manor use all the time. Also, I would like the field to be kept grass and not turf, because as Tony pointed out, we'd have to put a fence around it. And the residents of Bronxville Manor use that all the time as like play area when the school is closed. And I would like that to continue. The Cottle Auditorium is really too small for any good use. Even when we have events at the school, we have to split our assemblies into two different sessions because it can't fit all of our students. When we have our chorus events and our band events in the evenings for the parents, you're standing. There is absolutely not enough room for our families to watch our children. As it is, we have to split our concerts into three separate nights in order for the families to come and see their kids, and you're still standing. I would like, since the gym is proposed to be a much bigger space that could fit all those people, to see that auditorium be used as classroom space or additional learning space. And I do like the gym idea, only because I have been to modified volleyball games and basketball games where the parents, again, cannot even watch the game. You're up against the wall. The volleyball games, the balls are going up into the rafters. You cannot even have a decent set. And the basketball games, you are lined up against the wall, worried that the play is going to come right at you because there's not enough space to even stand to watch your game. Also, I would love to see in the main entrances of all of our schools handicap accessible entrances. It really bothers me that we do have parents and family members in the district who are in wheelchairs. Mine is one of them. And it bothers me that a parent cannot access their child's school from the main entrance if they are in a wheelchair. It's a real issue. And I would like to see that change, and I would like to see that a big priority. And my last concern is I do have a child who's in one of these bigger grades, and he's in second grade, and Cottle's issue is now. We are in our third year of needing a fifth class in kindergarten. Your plan says you're not going to be ready for 3 to 5 years. What is the plan for next year? What is the plan for the next 3 years? What are we going to do for our kids? That's it. Nothing? No.
Allison.
Can I just make one point?
Should okay, respond you, first.
Address? Okay.
I tried to summarize it earlier, but it looks like right now the pre-K that is in Cottle will need to leave for this upcoming year. After that, we are out of options. Another serious consideration is either to possibly have music travel, which we do not like. And then the next one after that is to relocate the district offices and move the fifth grade up. Other than that, there simply is no other space. We did discuss trailers, and someone else previously asked about trailers. According to our architect, they're roughly $200,000 to $250,000 per classroom. A little bit more involved than they were years back. You need to hook up electric and plumbing and all sorts of approvals from New York State. And I think the thought is, well, first, we have this blueprint that you've heard people speak about over and over, and we're pretty restricted. Where would we put the trailers was the first idea. Well, do we place them on the field and lose field? Do we place them in the parking lot and lose parking? Everyone has, I think, recognizes the parking issue. And then do we invest $400,000 to $500,000 for a few extra rooms? It's temporary, when maybe that money could be invested in something more permanent. So you're right, we are at a crossroads here, and we have some tough decisions to make, and we're in thoughtful discussion about that as an administrative team and with the board on a regular basis. So okay. Hopefully that answers some of your...
Okay, thank you.
Here's a really great idea. Really great idea, saving the community $25 million. Right over here, this is just a picture that is the second floor, but this piece of property, which is on the corner of Ridge and Siwanoy, belongs to the Kreutzers. Guess what? Their house is for sale. Buy it. I mean, you buy it, you have Mike Denning converted from a house into a four classrooms, and we saved $25 million. And, you know, it's done. It's done all the time. Iona does it. They bought a lot of houses around there. Concordia has done it. We can do it, too. And if that's not enough room, you make Tony Bonacore an offer he can't refuse, and you take his property over there. Make it whatever. You'd sell your property for $2
million. Joe's ready to sell it.
And that's it. No, seriously, these two... And then you wouldn't even have to float a bond. You just do a one-year assessment, and everybody's happy. That's the idea. And if you're open enough to come up with an idea of spending $31 million, then you should be open enough to the idea of looking at buying the Kreutzer's property.
Hi. Lenny Caratoro again. A quick question. What happens during the construction period with the, you know, classes going on, and what happens with that? How long is it, and are the kids displaced?
Well, it's done very carefully, and there's really specific rules about what you can and cannot do while kids are in school. So, for example, the second story addition, all the structural steel would be put up during the summer when nobody's there. But there's dust rules, fresh air rules, and noise limits that all must be observed. And that's part of the reason this takes more time than it would if it weren't an occupied school building.
Is this like a, looking at it as like a tiered project as far as you have phases?
It's going to be a number of phases, exactly. Because you can't do one thing until you make more space for the other thing. So that's why, you know, the first thing you would do is, if you do this proposal, would be build the gym and start the second floor. And then once you have the second floor usable, then you move the district office, because you can't take classrooms away from Cottle until you provide more. So it would be a carefully thought out steps to make sure it all works.
You know, Tony mentioned about like the high school playing here. Is there an issue with the high school and the gym playing now? Oh, okay. So there's not an issue playing in this gym with the varsity sports. Is there a minimum bond threshold? Minimum. So meaning is it 30,000? We need to do 30 million. Can you do 2 million? Can you do 5 million?
As far as I know, there's no minimum.
No minimum. Okay. So we're not held like it's, it has
there's
to be
different
30.
Ways. There's different procedures for different amounts of money based on what our capital.
And do we start with, like, how did the budget start? Do we have a proposed budget, or was it just a compilation of we want to do this, and this, and then came up with a figure? Did we start with a budget first and back into it, or did they kind of do the project and then do the budget? Did we think about, well, just as far as like the community itself, what can the community bear as far as a number before we went into the capital projects?
Well, all I can speak to is the process that was facilitated through the committee. We started with needs, just as you saw, enrollments, capacities, the spaces that are needed. We looked at a variety of options of different ways to accommodate it. And this is the one option that the committee brought to the board for discussion. Doesn't mean that all the others can't be looked at again.
Great. All right. Thank you.
Just real quick, this committee was built, Jim Reese had sent out an email about a year ago soliciting members of the community to step forward, and members of the community did. I think probably over 20 people just from the community that were on this committee. So this wasn't a small group of people. We invited everybody. We basically, I think Jim at the time didn't turn anybody away. If you wanted to be on the committee, you were on it, because we wanted to make it a fair representation of the community. Now, I'm going to do something. It's 9:53, and we have an email system for people to ask questions. I don't want this meeting to go past 10 o'clock, because I know people got to get up for work tomorrow. So why don't I don't want to cut a meeting short, but if you haven't asked a question yet, can I ask those folks to step forward first? And then if you've asked a question, then nobody else.
Could I just ask one quick question? If the district offices aren't relocated, how many classrooms could be right in that section? Four more, so 8 classrooms altogether.
Is there anyone who hasn't asked questions at once?
Hi, just, I know someone had mentioned something about the lights and everything. Did anyone discuss maybe solar panels or anything like that to maybe reduce any of those costs? I mean, everyone's putting them up all over town.
Yeah, we haven't gotten really that far into it, but we would look into it if it made sense. The second floor of Cottle might be a good location, yes.
Okay, well, if not that, like Mike said, forget about the gym, but if the gym had to go in, can they go up on the gym?
They could go up on the gym if we have the right exposure, sure.
Okay, just because, and how many people does that gym hold?
Well, it's the bleachers hold about 500, and it could hold as many as 1,100 people with seats on the floor.
Does our school district need something so massive?
We were just asked how many people
could hold. Oh, okay. I mean, I don't think we need something that big, but so I was just wondering. Is that like bigger than what we have here as far as gym?
I've been to that Somers gym to watch my daughter compete in a cheerleading competition. The first thing I said when I walked in, there's a boy with hands like this. And again, it's the first time we're hearing or seeing or hearing Somers. It's a beautiful facility. I mean, and I'm not trying to say the gym is the right thing or not, but it really impressed me when I went to Somers that, wow, this school is
nice. I'm sure they offered you parking, though, somewhere. honestly, I mean, forget about the gym being that big. I mean, we don't have parking now. So, honestly, the gym, if we can work with what we currently have, I think we should do that and forget the gym and give the kids classroom space, give them labs up at the high school if they need them there, science labs, whatever it is. I think that's the biggest part of it, to be honest with you. Leave the field as grass. Nothing wrong with playing on grass. We all grew up with grass. There's nothing wrong with that. And it's less to maintain, I think, over the years. No, I understand. This is just being presented to you just as it is with us. But if you can, I did speak to some people who don't have kids in the district, and they had no idea that this was going on at all. So they were kind of like, well, wait a minute. And, we said it was just to get the presentation going. But they want to know how do they get notified? They're residents of, they're taxpayers of the school district, and they haven't been notified. They didn't even know that anything like this was even in the talks.
So Lee, you could probably comment on notification of the public, I would think, if there is a vote today. And again, as I started off the meeting, one of the first things I encourage is that if you know people who aren't in the school committee, tell them to go to the website. If they're, help them out. We're a community. So there's only so much the district can do to make the community aware if they're not going to be able to go on the website and do things like that. I really do encourage everybody listening to encourage the community members who are not in the school
decision. We also have spoken with the town, and we are going to have a part of their meeting where they're going to read a report at the town meetings as well. and put things on their website, but they are doing it maybe three times a year. So it's actually coming up for their November meeting. So the residents that don't have kids that do go on the Tuckahoe website should see it then as well.
Yep. You just have some seniors who don't use, and they were kind of a little surprised that something like this would even...
We could utilize maybe the civic associations in Bronxville Manor and Chester Heights and...
Or if you... Oh, actually, never mind. The school calendar's out already. I was going to say maybe put a little blurb, but no. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Have a good night.
Just remember, there was 20 people on this committee, and Russ proposed it and said, here's option A or B. We got it down to A or B, and he asked which one should we present to the board, and I think 18 or 19 out of the 20 or 21 people all asked for A. So that's how we got to this point. So Tony was against it, yes. He wanted more options. I said you wanted more options.
I think, Tony, you have to go to the microphone because people can't hear you.
So Tony basically said that the board said that they only want one option.
Did we say we only want one option?
I think that was our...
It was one option to start, yes.
Which is the whole, if there's one option to start, we want to see, which is give us that that's what it looks like. So the community knows that this is the first meeting. You know, we'll be back here December 5th, and I think the question will there be other options. What I'm hearing is people want to see other options, so I don't see why.
How you doing? My name is Raymond Inello. I live at 9 Central Drive. I think there's something we could do with our existing gym without creating this mass facility. Somewhere in that space, using maybe taking the space from the outside classroom and expanding that whole facility there, maybe taking that whole gym down and rebuilding it to the biggest it could be there. Also, just adding 4 classrooms. I don't think the community is growing exponentially, and doing a 5 or 10 year study is not going to predict how many kids are going to happen. I think we have to look at 10 and 20 year trends of homeowners and families, because I think a lot of the community, the people that live here, eventually are going to be empty nesters that are going to be just still living here. And the houses aren't turning over like you're, you know, stocking a shelf in a grocery store. So I think we're probably at the peak. We may be 3 or 4 years still at this peak, but then eventually I think it's going to start to trend downward one way or the other. And a great option would be to either rent or purchase existing properties in the community to use for office space so that we have an option to then downsize. Say, you know, we don't need this house anymore. We could now sell it versus having this big expense that just doesn't go away. You know, there were years and years at East Chester High School, the third floor was never used for years and years. And I'm afraid that maybe once this is all done, first of all, I think 4 classrooms is not enough, but the wave of kids are going to start to decrease. And I think we really have to look at the long-term trends of homeowners and what families are doing and how people are getting older and staying in their homes, not leaving. So thank you.
Michelle's. If you go online to tuckoschools.org, there'll be a page there where you can get all these presentations and information. If you have questions that weren't answered tonight and you're in attendance or watching at home, either live on the stream or tomorrow, which would be now because it would be tomorrow when you're watching this, go to capitalproject@tuckoschools.org. We'll monitor that email. There'll be some FAQs up there. And the next time we'll discuss this will be the December 5th board workshop. I wish everybody a safe travel home, and thanks again for everybody coming. We'll see you soon.